I am J. Harold Smith, speaker for the Radio Bible Hour, located in Newport, Tennessee. This video message was taped in the auditorium of the First Baptist Church of Pigeon Forge, Tennessee, where Dr. William Cope is the great pastor. We are indebted to this church, to this great pastor, for the use of their auditorium and of their equipment in being able to present to you this message entitled, Wearing the Clothes of Christ, But Lost. Mark chapter 15 and verse 17. And they clothed him with purple and put in a crown of thorns and put it about his head and began to salute him, Hail, King of the Jews. And they smote him on the head with a reed, and did spit upon him, and bowing their knees, worshipped him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple from him, and put his own clothes on him, and led him out to crucify him. And they compelled one Simon, a Cyrenian, who passed by, coming out of the country, the father of Alexandra and Rufus, to bear his cross. And they bring him unto the place Golgotha, which is being interpreted the place of a skull. And they gave him to drink wine mingled with myrrh, but he received it not. And when they had crucified him, they parted his garments, casting lots upon them what every man should take. Now, in reading that portion of the Word of God that I've just read, you'll remember the incident. The trial of our Lord was over. Pilate had just sentenced him to die the most agonizing death ever devised in the mind of men, the death of crucifixion. He had been exchanged for a robber. The Redeemer had been turned down by the Jews, and a robber had been selected in his place to go free. A murderer instead of the master. The Bible declares that a criminal instead of Christ. The Bible declares that a seditionist rather than the sovereign God had been chosen by that mob that was screaming, crucify him, crucify him. The soldiers had spit in his face. They had plucked out part of his beard. They had bowed down before him in mockery. And they had put upon him a purple robe signifying royalty and bowed down in mock worship to our Lord. And now we find him. Already he has made that trip from that courtroom to the cross. Now they have nailed him to that tree, and here he hangs between two thieves. The Bible declares that while he was hanging there, they had stripped his garments, his robe, and the soldiers at the foot of the cross were now gambling, casting lots to see who would win the cloak of the Lord Jesus Christ, or the robe of our wonderful Lord. I have never in all of my life heard a preacher preach from this passage of Scripture. I have never heard nor read a sermon where that soldier that won those clothes of Christ walked away wearing the clothes of Christ but lost. And then I want to use for our theme and for our subject, wearing the clothes of Christ, but lost. The Bible does not tell us who that soldier was that won that garment. But that garment was blood-stained. And when he carelessly threw it around his shoulders and walked away from that cross, he did not realize that he had on the clothes of Christ, but his heart, his soul was doomed and damned for hell. And I do believe tonight the great tragedy of this hour is to find so many people that have on the clothes of Christ, but they do not have Jesus. They wear the robes of religion, but they do not know the Redeemer in their heart. They have religion on their back, and they have sin in their hearts. And as a result of it, we see today hundreds and hundreds of people that are lost. The Bible declares that many are called, but few are chosen. We find that many today who name the name of Jesus but deny the power of his resurrection. We have many today that have a form of godliness but deny the power. We have many that wear the outer garments of Christ, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Inwardly, brother, I tell you, they are clouds without water. They are dumb dogs that cannot bark. They are wallowing sows. So states the Bible. When I stop to think about all of this multitude today that have religion, but no Redeemer. They have a church, but no Christ. They have baptism, but they have no blood. They have the clothes of Christ, but they do not have our wonderful Redeemer. And as I look into the Bible, I find many, many illustrations of this truth. For example, the first one that comes to my mind is Nicodemus. I do not believe that there ever lived a more righteous man than Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a ruler of the Jews. The Bible declares that he was one of the three richest men, or we know from history that he was one of the three richest men in all of Jerusalem. He was a member of the Sanhedrin. He was a respected and honored man. He fasted twice a week. The Bible declares that he was a tither. He gave a tithe of all of his income. He was loyal to his synagogue and to the temple. You would not have found a more loyal man in all of Jerusalem than Nicodemus. And when Nicodemus came to our Lord by night, wearing the robes of religion, but lost, our Lord looked him in the face and said, Nicodemus, marvel not that I say unto thee, ye must be born again. The doctrine of the new birth is a forgotten doctrine in many of our churches. But I do not believe that any man will ever get to heaven that doesn't experience the new birth. And that new birth comes not through the clothes of Christ, but through Christ and his shed blood. So you may be as righteous as Nicodemus and still go to hell. You may wear the robes of religion and still be damned and lost forever. Tragedy of tragedies. The saddest thing in all of the universe is for a man to lose his soul and die without God and without hope in this world. It would have been better if you had never been born than to die without Christ. As I look in the Word of God, I find another illustration of this truth. You'll remember the Pharisees were the religious leaders of that day, and the Word of God says that they wore the robe of religion, but underneath they were hypocrites. The Bible declares that they were famous for their long prayers. They were famous for their knowledge of the Scriptures. They were famous for obeying all of the ordinances. They were famous for keeping all of the law. But down underneath all of that religious activities, they were lost. It doesn't make any difference how many times you attend church. You may have a record and wear little badges of how many Sundays you've been to the house of God. You may have hanging up on your walls many, many honors that have been given to you because of your study courses and because of your completion of this or that or the other. But that isn't salvation. All of our formality, all of our creeds and all of our dogmas amount to nothing if the Lord Jesus Christ is not in your heart. The Pharisees wore the clothes of religion, but they were lost. Jesus Christ said, woe unto you scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites. The judgment of God and the damnation of hell is going to be your portion. I look in the Bible and I find another character that had religion, but he was lost. His name was Judas. When I realize that Judas wore the clothes of Christ for 3.5 years. And certainly, my friends, there perhaps was not a disciple that was any closer to Jesus than Judas. I may be wrong, but I believe he was the most trusted of all of the 12 men that the Lord had chosen, because they had selected him as a treasurer. We find that he was the only one that ever mentioned the poor. But the Bible declares that all the disciples thought that he was a disciple. But our Lord, who selected him, knew that he was a demon, a devil. And the Lord said, "Have I not chosen you 12, and one of you, is a devil." So all the time the disciples thought that this was another disciple, our Lord was not deceived. He knew all the time that he was a devil. And there's a tremendous difference between a devil and a disciple. When I realized that our wonderful Lord, when he established his church, when he selected these 12 men, one of them was a demon and one of them was a devil. So if you have a church membership of 1,200, and you've got 120 devils in it, you're still running according to the same percentage as the Lord. And I never have found a church, never in all of my life, wherever I traveled, I have never found a church in all of my life that didn't have at least one devil in that congregation. Now, you can act like a disciple. You can talk like a disciple. You can walk like a disciple. You can go in the company of disciples and still be a devil. What a tragedy. I think that if I had to choose to go to hell, I'd want to go to hell from a bootleg joint and a dive of iniquity rather than from a Baptist church. I cannot imagine anything any more embarrassing. I cannot imagine anything any worse than one of these days you could die and you've been on the deacon board and you've been a Sunday school teacher and you've been a leader in this church and you die without the Lord Jesus Christ. You die with his clothes, but you die without Christ. And you hear the Lord say, "Depart from me, ye work of iniquity. I never knew you." And you say, "Just a minute, Lord. You don't know who I am. Lord, you don't really know who I am." And you begin to name your church and say, "Lord, I was a member of thus and thus church. And so is my pastor, Lord. Surely you've made a mistake." And the Lord says, "You've had the clothes of Christ. You've had the robes of religion. But you've never, never had Christ in your heart. You've never really been born again. Depart from me, ye worker of iniquity." One of the saddest sights in all of the Bible is when God said, "Noah, come into the ark." God left that door open for 7 days. And on the 7th day, after the animals had gone in and the fowl of the air had gone in, the Bible says that God shut to the door of that ark. And no sooner than the door was shut and the judgment of God began to fall upon that antediluvian world, and they began to see the terrible storm that was raging and the floodwaters, as they began to rise, they came. And one of the saddest pictures in all of the Bible is when they began to beat on the door of that ark and say, "Noah, let us in, Noah. We sold you the gopher wood that was in this ark. We were the one that sold you the pitch that was in this ark. Let us in, Noah." And I see Noah say, "Ham, Shem, Japheth, help me. Let's see if we can open this door and let our friends and our neighbors in." But when God shuts to the door, no man will ever be able to open it. And one of these days when you stand in the presence of God wearing only the clothes of Christ and with no Christ, and God says, "Depart from me, ye work of iniquity, I never knew you," hell's going to be your portion and the lake of fire is going to be your eternal doom. I wonder tonight, as you look into your heart, what do you see? Christ or just his clothes? On occasions, the Bible tells us that the devil himself can adorn himself as an angel of light. The Bible says that he is so subtle and cunning and deceitful that many, my dear friends, look at him and admire him and think he's an angel of light when he is the angel of darkness. Humanism today comes in the form of an angel of light. Communism today struts out across the nations of this earth as a benefactor and as an angel of light. But underneath all of the liberalism and modernism and communism and humanism is Satan. Underneath all of Satanism, witchcraft, fortune telling, and all of that is the devil, the cunning of the devil, wearing the clothes of Christ but lost, wearing the clothes of Christ but a demon and a devil himself. Then I tell you, occasionally it's possible for a preacher to wear the clothes of Christ and not have Christ. That's a tragedy of tragedies. I believe that every man that is called of God to preach has a special anointing. I'm glad that my mother didn't call me to preach. I'm glad that my grandmother didn't call me to preach. I'm glad that my neighbors didn't call me to preach. I'm glad that my pastor did not call me to preach. I'm glad that my wife did not call me to preach. I'm glad that I was called by the Lord. And he called me the very second he saved me. And when we are called to preach, you can never trade that wonderful, marvelous gift of God for anything else unless you step down. I would not trade my call to preach if I could become not the President of the United States, but the President of and dictator of the whole world. I'd rather be a humble preacher on the backside of Podunk Mountain, a faithful preacher of the gospel, than anything else in all the world. I've searched the Bible through many times. I've looked for the word, how shall they hear without a doctor? But I can't find it. It says, how shall they hear without a what? A preacher. And so the greatest thing in all the world is to be a preacher. But a preacher that only has a covering, only a cloth covering, and only wears the garments of the Lord Jesus Christ, and down underneath, he is a ravening wolf. Down underneath, he is a deceiver and a false prophet. They are indeed worse than any other character that you can mention. I had rather be a dope pusher. I had rather be a dope abuser. I'd rather be an alcoholic. I'd rather be a drunkard. I'd rather be a whoremonger. I'd rather be a liar and a thief than to be a preacher. I'm sitting with a garment of religion, but underneath, but I carry the spirit of the devil and be a wolf inside of a sheepskin. Now the word of God declares that a deacon can also be a deceiver. We can attend church. We can win attendance badges. We can be kindly disposed toward the pastor. And we can be the most liberal giver in the congregation and still be lost. Now it's possible also for a church to have the clothes of Christ, but not have Christ. The Church of Laodicea, the Bible says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Jesus Christ was on the outside. He was not in that church. No wonder they were poor and wretched and miserable and blind. Isn't it wonderful that when you go into a church, you can tell whether God is there or not? Have you ever gone into a church where you'd feel by the very spirit of Satan? Have you ever gone and heard a preacher by the preach and go out of the service and say, I wish I had never heard that man preach. He did nothing for me. What in the world did he talk about? There are churches today where the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ is not preached, where the blood is never mentioned, where the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, not even on Easter, is mentioned, where they talk about a bunny rabbit and talk about an Easter egg, And brother, I tell you, instead of talking about the bodily resurrection of our Lord, they turn away from that wonderful truth. There are those today that actually deny the blood, the precious blood of the Lord Jesus. And some of the denominations are taking the blood hymns out of all of their hymn books. And there are many of our churches today where the preacher never mentions hell. He never mentions heaven. He never mentions sin. He never mentions Satan. He never talks about how that you must repent of your sins or die in those sins and be lost forever. Those churches have the clothes, the garments of religion, but they do not have Christ. It is possible for such a church to kick Jesus Christ out of the fellowship. They major in playing instead of prayer. They believe in a good time instead of grace. They believe in lust and substitute it for love. They have more soup in their kitchen than they have spirit in their auditorium. They have more sensation than they have separation. They have more divorce in all of their congregation than they have devotion. They have worldliness instead of worship. They have hate instead of holiness. They have blasphemy instead of blamelessness. They have sex for separation. They have storytelling for sermons. They have turmoil for triumph. They have vice for victory. They have a supper room instead of the upper room. They have murmuring instead of mourning. They have tea and substituted for tears. They have coffee instead of consecration. They have fish instead of faith. They have oysters instead of obedience. They have substituted salad for salvation. They have substituted potatoes for power. They have substituted jelly for joy. They have substituted carnality for Christianity. They have substituted Satan for Christ. They have a form of godliness but deny the power of thereof. These churches are lifeless. And my dear friends, to get life, you must have life. To get life and to win lost souls, you must have Christ. Saul of Tarsus wore the clothes of Christ, but was lost. Did Saul have religion? Did Saul of Tarsus have religion? Was he willing to fight for that religion? The Word of God declares that Saul was so zealous for God that when the Christians began to preach Christ and he saw all of these people turning away from the temple and turning to the Lord Jesus Christ, he was so angry until he asked for permission not only to destroy all of the saints that he could find in Jerusalem, but he went down and got permission and got the papers all signed so that he could go to Damascus and there arrest and bring back to Jerusalem for trial all of those that named the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And halfway down to Damascus, that was a light that shined round about him, brighter than the noonday sun. And he heard a voice from heaven saying, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" And when he fell on the ground with his face toward the earth, he cried out and said, "Lord, who art thou?" And that same voice came back from heaven saying, "I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom thou persecutest. Saul, it is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." And then he said, "Lord, what wilt thou have me to do?" Jesus said, "I want you to go down to Damascus. There a man will meet you and tell you what to do. I'm going to show you, Saul, how many things you're going to have to suffer for my name's sake." But he had religion. But not only he got on the Damascus road, did he have Christ. Up on that hour, he wore the clothes of Christ. He wore the robes of religion. But he was a lost man and on his way to hell. And had he gone on to Damascus and refused to have listened to that voice from heaven, Saul of Tarsus would have never become the great Apostle Paul. He would have never become the greatest preacher that ever lived, the most marvelous preacher of grace that ever lived upon the face of this earth. He would have never become that mighty man of God if he had disobeyed the voice of God and said, "My clothes, my robes of religion are sufficient." He realized he had to have Christ. To have the clothes of Christ without having Christ is like having a body without a soul. It's like having a nut without a kernel. It's like having a cloud without water. It's like having an engine without steam. And it's like having a car without gasoline. Are you content just to wear the clothes of Christ? Evidently, these gamblers were content with their gain. I do not know why the Holy Spirit, and I do not question him, why he did not name this man, this soldier that won that garment. But somewhere out in that crowd was standing Mary, the mother of our Lord. Somewhere out in that crowd was Barabbas, the one that the Jews had said, "Release unto us Barabbas and crucify Christ." That third cross on which Jesus Christ was hanging was intended for Barabbas. That day they were going to crucify three criminals while it was Barabbas. And when Pilate was reminded that on this occasion it was always the custom to release one prisoner, one. And they made the decision it would be Barabbas instead of the blessed Son of God. What a tragedy. And somewhere out there in that great mob that was watching Jesus die was Barabbas. And surely he must have thought, that cross was my cross. That man is dying in my stead. And about that time the sun began to go out. About that time the lightning began to flash and the thunder began to rumble. And about that time the wind began to whirl and blow it with a tremendous blow. And about that time the earth began to reel back and forth. And from the foot of that cross, the centurion who had given the order that Jesus Christ would be nailed to the tree smote himself upon the chest and cried out and said, "Surely, surely, this man is the Son of God." All of that. And yet, I tell you, standing around that cross were the Pharisees, the scribes, the Sadducees, the Jews, and they all said, "We are content just to have religion and not the Redeemer." I imagine that soldier that won that garment went, when that storm began to rage, he went immediately to his quarters, or maybe to his home. Maybe his little boy met him and saw that blood all over that garment and thought that his soldier father had been wounded, and he ran to him and said, "Daddy, have you been wounded?" "No," he said, "this is not my blood. This is the blood of a man that we crucified today by the name of Jesus." Jesus? I could hear the little boy say, "Did you say that they crucified Jesus? That's the one." "Well, Father, I saw him when he opened the eyes of a blind man. And I was present, Father, when he fed a great multitude with just two small fish and five barley loaves." Jesus, the one that could walk upon the water, the one that could cleanse lepers, the one that could unstop the ears, surely, Daddy, you didn't have a part in crucifying him. "Yes, Son, I did. I was the one that drove the nails into his hand. And fortunately, I was the one that cast the right lot and won his garment. Look at it. It doesn't have a seam in it, not one. And Mother can wash the blood out." Let me tell you, it's not enough just to put on a blood-stained garment, even if that blood is the blood of Jesus. That blood is not to be applied to your back, it's to be applied to your heart, to your soul. What a tragedy. Can you imagine that man when he came down to die? That soldier that went away from that cross with the clothes of Christ but no Jesus? know Christ? What a difference between he and that thief that believed. As those two thieves railed upon the Lord Jesus Christ in his dying moment, one of them said, "This man has done nothing amiss. I'm getting exactly what I deserve, and you're getting exactly what you deserve. This man right here is taking the place of Barabbas, our fellow prisoner, the one that we stayed with last night. And he was chosen by the Jews, and this man, Christ, was nailed to this cross in the place of Barabbas. He has done nothing amiss." And about that time, when the old earth began to tremble and the blackness came on, out of the darkness he cried, "Lord, when thou comest into thy kingdom, remember me." And the Lord Jesus Christ turned and looked toward that dying thief and said, "Today shalt thou be with me in paradise." And there on that cross, that thief, but I should have put on Christ. And in a few hours, when our Lord had died, although his body was still hanging upon that cross and was waiting the funeral, waiting the dressing and the anointing and the wrapping of the body in linens and spices by Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, waiting to be buried in Joseph's tomb, Christ himself had departed out of that body and gone to paradise. Paradise. Hades is divided into two sections. Paradise and hell. The rich man that died and was buried lifted his eyes up in hell. Abraham, when he died, went to paradise. Lazarus, that was full of sores at the rich man's gate, when he died, he went to paradise. And when Jesus Christ died upon that cross, he went to paradise. And for 3 days and 3 nights he preached. Now, I may be wrong in what I'm about to say, but I believe that the most surprised person that ever went to paradise was that thief. He had watched Jesus die. Before they came to break his bones and hurry on with his death, he saw that soldier lift that spear and thrust it into the side of Jesus Christ. He heard the gushing out of the water and the blood as it came out of that open wound. He saw that. And now he has just died and steps into paradise. And lo and behold, the man that was on that center cross is standing preaching. And I believe that the Lord Jesus Christ paused for just a moment and said, "Folk, I want to introduce you to this man. He died by my side today in Jerusalem. He was a thief. He was a robber. He was a murderer. He was a seditionist. But he called on me in his dying moment and asked me to remember him when I came into my kingdom. And I promised him that today he would be with me in paradise." And folk, I believe that man just stood there in amazement. He could hardly believe his eyes. Here was this wonderful, marvelous person called Christ. Now he was standing preaching to all of the host that had died in the Lord. And he would have never experienced that had he not put on Christ. I just wonder, my friends, if you will go into eternity and have the Lord to say, "You didn't put Christ on. You didn't put off this and you didn't put on Christ. As a result of it, you're doomed and damned for eternity, lost forever." When we are born again, we are in Christ. We are for Christ. We are like Christ. We are with Christ. To be in Christ, my friends, and not his clothes, is to acknowledge his virgin birth, to acknowledge his sinless life, to acknowledge his vicarious death, to acknowledge his physical resurrection and to believe and trust and look for his glorious second coming. I want to ask you, are you like this soldier that died wearing the cross, or that thief that died wearing the garments of Jesus and Christ? Are you like that soldier that walked away from the foot of the cross that day with a bloody robe of Jesus upon his back, but his heart without Christ? Are you a new creature? Are all things become new to you? Have the things that you once loved now become things that you hate? And are the things that you once hated now become the things that you love? Do you really know that your name is recorded upon the Lamb's Book of Life? You say, oh, Brother Harold, I remember, way back then when I was a little boy, I remember when I was a little girl, I walked down the church one night, and I told the preacher that I wanted to join the church. And I signed a card, and a few days later, I was baptized. That isn't it. That isn't putting on Christ. I did the same thing. When I was 12 years old, I walked down the aisle of a Southern Baptist church, and the preacher met me at the aisle, and he said, do you want to join the church? I said, I suppose so. He said, would you like to be baptized? I said, I reckon. He said, sit down there on the front seat, fill out this little card. I sat down and filled out a little card, and 2 weeks later, I was baptized, and for the next 10 years, I was in that church, lost, because I had on only the clothes of Christ and did not have Christ on. But on September the 4th, 1932, sitting up on the front porch of my sister's home in Greenville, she said to me, Harold, you've tried everything that the devil has to offer. Why don't you give Jesus Christ a chance in your heart? And there on that front porch, I got out of that chair and down on my knees, and I said, oh God, have mercy on me, a sinner, and the Lord save me. And I've put on Christ, and since that day, I have walked in Christ. He is more real to me than my wife. He is more real to me than my son and my daughter. He is more real to me than my grandson and my granddaughter. He is more real to me than any friend that I have. Do you really know? Do you really know that you have Christ in your heart? You say, I'm a church member. I've been baptized. I go to Sunday school. I tithe. I read my daily Bible readings. Brother Harold, I don't drink. I've never taken an upper or a downer. I've never smoked a joint of marijuana. Preacher, I've never snorted cocaine. I've never sniffed glue. Preacher, I was voted the most outstanding and popular man in our community, in our city. Every Sunday, I give a tithe of all that I make to my church. And I say, that's not it. Have you truly repented, turned around from the way you were going, and trusted Jesus Christ and his blood alone to redeem you? If you haven't, it doesn't make any difference how much religion you may have. If you do not have the Redeemer, you're lost. Sad, tragic hour when you stand before God and hear him say, depart from me. Ye worker of iniquity, I never knew you. Wait a minute, Lord. Lord, I preached. Lord, in your name I cast out devils. In your name, Lord, I did many wonderful works. And the Lord's going to say, I still say, I do not know you, because you only have works and you do not have Christ. Tonight, for the salvation of your soul, you need just one person. That's Christ. You just need one thing to wash away your sins. Not the waters of baptism, not your good works, but the precious blood. The Bible declaring that the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanseth us from all sin. Do you believe it? Well, if his blood cleanses us from all sin, that leaves absolutely nothing for water or works to wash away. I close this message by asking you one more time, Do you have Christ in your heart, or do you have just his clothes, all of their bloodstained, upon your back?